Corvus the Crow constellation is an easy one to find in the night sky. From March to June, Corvus sits right next to Virgo, Crater the Cup, and Hydra the water snake. This trapezoid-shaped star pattern can be seen from both hemispheres, and the key to finding Corvus is using the Big Dipper asterism. You arc to Arcturus, and then you speed to Spica. This bright blue star guides the way to finding Corvus. In this video, we will review how to find Corvus, the celestial objects within its boundaries, and the ancient mythologies connected to this star pattern. Corvus is classified as an ancient constellation. The earliest records of it exist in the Babylonian star catalogs, written around 1100 BCE. Astronomer Claudius Ptolemy also included Corvus in the Almagest, written in the 2nd century. The name Corvus is Latin for crow or raven, and it is also classified as a seasonal constellation, which means it can only be seen during certain parts of the year. So when can you see Corvus? It's best seen through the months of March into June, and it's right next to Virgo in the sky. Virgo is a really large constellation, but most of its stars are very faint, and it only has one bright star called Spica. Spica is really easy to find. You use the handle of the Big Dipper to arc to Arcturus and speed to Spica. Then you look for the trapezoid shape right next to the bright blue star of Spica. The stars of Corvus are fairly even in magnitude, making it really easy to identify in the sky. Obvious pattern of Corvus consists of four main stars, Delta, Gamma, Epsilon, and Beta Corvi. They create a quadrilateral asterism known as the sail. Although none of the stars are extremely bright, they are located in a dim section of the sky, making the asterism really easy to spot. Now let's use Stellarium to get some practice on how to find Corvus in the night sky. And the key to this is finding Ursa Major. And look for the Big Dipper pattern within the larger Ursa Major pattern. You use the handle of the Big Dipper to arc to Arcturus and then speed to Spica. Remember that Spica is a bright blue star, and it's the brightest one in Virgo. Most of the stars in Virgo are very faint, but it is a large constellation. Once you find Spica, you want to look for the quadrilateral-shaped pattern in the sky next to the bright blue star. It's fairly easy to point out. Notice that Crater is right next to Corvus, and Hydra snakes across a large portion of the sky. I've recently been able to identify Hydra in the night sky, and I do feel it's probably one of those impossible constellations to photograph because it's just so huge, and you can only see parts of it throughout the night. If we were to take off the star patterns, notice the brighter stars, you should be able to find the Big Dipper right there. You arc to Arcturus, speed to Spica, and then right here is that star pattern. So let's briefly review the characteristics of each star. Geena, which is Gamma Corvi, marks the left wing of the raven. This is the brightest star in Corvus, despite its gamma designation. It's a binary star system located approximately 150 light years from Earth. The main star is a Class A blue main sequence star, and the secondary star is a red dwarf star that is smaller than our own sun. The second star, Kras, is Beta Corvi, and it marks the raven's breast. This yellow giant star is estimated to be 146 light years away. It is over three times the mass of our own sun, and it has begun to evolve off the main sequence. Algarab is Delta Corvi. It's a binary star system located roughly 87 light years away. Epsilon Corvi has the common name of Minkar, and this is Arabic for Beak of the Crow. It is a red giant star with a stellar classification of K23, and it's starting to consume the hydrogen at its core, and it's beginning to move and evolve away from the main sequence band. It's estimated to have about three times the mass of the sun. Alcyba, or Alpha Corvi, is another star that's a little off from the main four bright stars, and despite its alpha designation, it is not the brightest star of Corvus. It is classified as an F main sequence star, and it's estimated to be 49 light years away from Earth. Now let's review the celestial objects within the boundaries of Corvus. There are a pair of galaxies cataloged as NGC 4038 and 4039. Together, they are known as the Antennae galaxies. These two interacting galaxies are located about 45 million light years away, and they are famous for their shape. The merging galaxies have antenna-like tails emanating from the disk of the galaxies, and it is hypothesized that these antennae were formed by interacting gravitational forces during the time of their collision. The second celestial object to identify is called NGC 4361. This is a planetary nebula that lies right at the center of the trapezoid pattern of Corvus. It has a faint halo to it, and it's easy to see the white dwarf in the center of the nebula. Remember that a planetary nebula is the final stage of death for stars that have a mass of 1 to 4 suns. In the final portion of this video, we'll take a look at some of the ancient mythologies connected to Corvus the Raven. In Babylonian mythology, Corvus was referred to as the Raven, and this dates back to at least 1100 BCE. Here, Corvus was depicted sitting on a serpent's tail, which is very similar to the Greek Hydra, which will come later in history. This star pattern represented Adad, the deity of rain and storms. In Greek mythology, the constellation Corvus depicts Apollo's crow. In one myth, Apollo commands his crow to fetch water in a cup for a sacrifice, but the crow spends several days waiting for figs to ripen near a fig tree. When the crow returns to Apollo, he blames the water snake for obstructing the spring. Apollo sees through this deception and launches the crow, the cup, and the water snake into the air. And you can see this story depicted on this map. You have the raven, the cup, and the water snake, which all are constellations in the sky. In many cultures, ravens and crows are commonly associated with intelligence. They serve as messengers. They have a sense of mystery about them, and in some cases, ill omens. But no matter what, there are many mythologies throughout the world about the constellations, and this is just a small portion of the ones that I have learned. If you have any stories or legends about this constellation from your area of the world, feel free to share that in the comments below. We've come to the end of our video about Corvus the Crow, so let's review everything we've learned so far. It's best seen in the springtime in the northern hemisphere, which is the autumn season for the southern hemisphere. It's classified as a seasonal constellation, and the best way to find Corvus is to use the Big Dipper to arc to Arcturus and then speed to Spica. You then look for Corvus near Spica. The celestial objects that are within the boundaries of Corvus include the Antennae galaxies and NGC 4361, which is a planetary nebula. If you want to see these celestial objects, you do need a telescope to spot them. So let me know in the comments below, have you been able to see Corvus in the night sky? I find that this is a pretty easy one to see, and I've been looking at it for years and didn't even recognize that it was a constellation. So sometimes that can happen along your journey. It's like you recognize a star pattern, and then years later, you're like, oh, that is actually a pattern. And then you can go on that deep dive on your own time to learn a little bit more about this constellation. So if you have any questions for me, leave them in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching. And as always, take a friend with you or a pet, go outside, spend that time in nature, and keep looking up.